your burdens down. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save.
Morning. The song tells us that all we want and all we need is found in Him. Let's stand and seek His face together as we sing. Never changing God. My name is Jeremy Willits, and I have the privilege of serving as one of the associate pastors here, and I want to give you a warm welcome, and just want to say we are celebrating this weekend, Memorial Day, and as always, we are thankful for those that serve our country, and we take special time to really appreciate those that have sacrificed, whether it be family members, loved ones, or friends that have sacrificed and given their lives to protect the freedoms that we enjoy and experience on a daily basis. So we give a special thanks and a remembrance for those that have sacrificed for our freedoms. I also want to give a special welcome to visitors that are here today. And I'd like to draw your attention to the pew rack right in front of you if you're visiting. There's a little card right there that says Calvary Connection. We would love to know that you are joining with us today in worship. And so I would ask that you just fill out that information and you can make that your offering as the offering plate goes by later in the service today. Also, if you're new to Calvary or maybe you've been away for a while and you're new again to Calvary, we'd love to personally welcome you and greet you and know that you are here. And so there, after the service, there is a reception that takes place in the Fellowship Center, which is straight through the lobby into the next main room there. There's a team there that would love to know that you are here today, love to greet you, love to welcome you. So I encourage you just to stop by there and let us know that you are here with us today. Also want to let everyone know that we are in the process of updating the Calvary website. If you head to calvarybible.org, you're going to notice that we've already made some significant changes to the appearance and layout of the site, so it'll look a little bit differently. Additional updates to the information and content will be coming soon as well. I just want to draw your attention to that because we want you to know that we want that to be a main area of information, so we're taking some time to make sure that it is a valuable tool. Also, tickets for the Sing an Irish Christmas concert with the Geddes and the Calvary Choir go on sale on June 1. Please see your bulletins for more information about that. I also have a very exciting praise announcement that I have the opportunity to share with you today, and it is concerning Mike Didos and his need for a liver. Late on May 13th, the Didos family received a call that a liver had been found for Mike. The next day, May 14th, Mike received a successful liver transplant surgery. His body has responded well to the liver, and recovery has been very positive up to this point. Mike was actually discharged from the hospital this last Thursday to continue his recovery at home.
We really want to thank everybody for their prayers, for the thoughts, and for the encouragement that everyone has had for the Didos family. And a special thanks goes to those who were inquiring about the possibility of being a donor. It's a joy to share this praise and how God has answered those prayers. Yes. We often have the opportunity to ask the congregation to be praying for significant requests, and it is a wonderful joy to be letting you know also of the praises and the answered prayers that God has given. So we continue to pray for Mike's body and that it will continue to recover well from the surgery. At this time, I'm going to ask Phil Smith to come up, and he's going to continue our service in prayer. Phil serves as one of the elders here at Calvary.
Thank you. Shall we continue in prayer? Lord, we do thank you for the privilege we have, the liberty we have to gather here this morning and to worship you. We thank you for the many that have given their lives to provide us with the freedoms that we have. But we also thank you for the liberty and the freedom we have in Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you and praise you this morning for the work that you have done in Mike Didos' life. We thank you for providing this liver. We thank you for the successful surgery and for the recuperation that's going on now. And we just praise you and thank you for your answer to our prayers. Lord, this morning I pray that you would help us to focus on you through our worship, through the ministry of the Word of God. Lord, as Pastor Brett comes, open our hearts to the Word of God and teach us. And then may the love and the grace and the glory of Jesus Christ be seen in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. We are so blessed to be able to gather in His presence. Amen. But please stand and let's receive this call to worship from Psalm 104. It reads, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. He lays the beams of his chambers on the waters. He makes the clouds his chariot. He rides on the wings of the wind. He makes his messengers winds, his ministers a flaming fire." Oh, what a glorious God we have to worship. Let's lift our voices together.
Worship the King, all glorious above, and gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Oh, tell of His might, oh, sing of His grace, whose robe is the light, whose canopy space. His chariots of wrath, the deep thunder clouds form, and dark is His path on the wings of the storm. How tender, how firm to the end, our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend. You alone are the matchless King, to you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders, what tongue can recite? You breathe in the air, you shine in the light.
Shine in the light.
above and gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, revealing in splendor and girding with praise.
Amen. And he welcomes us freely into his presence because of the free gift of Christ. Through faith, by grace, it is received. Let's celebrate that together in this next song. Praise. And we know it's not a gift that we could return to you, but we thank you that we can return praise to you and sing with confidence in your presence. Lord, we pray that you would bless these offerings, and both in the giving of them and also in the fruit that comes from them, we ask that you would transform our hearts, that you would deepen our walk with you, our knowledge of you, and our understanding of your strength, the adequacy and the sufficiency of all that you have given us. Transform our hearts, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Your armor on.
strength that God has given, with shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold, whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure. Christ will have the prize for which he died, an inheritance of nations. Son of God is stricken, and see his foes lie crushed beneath his feet, for the conqueror has risen. And as the stone is rolled away, and Christ emerges from the grave, this victory march continues till the day, every eye and heart shall see.
Your prayer.
So Spirit come, put strength in every stride, give grace for every hurdle, and we may run with faith to win the prize of a servant good and faithful. As saints of old still line the way, retelling triumphs of His grace, we hear their calls and hunger for when with Christ we stand in glory.
Father, thank you that you are preparing us as a radiant bride to stand before your throne. And we pray that in this time, as we turn our ears to your word, you would teach us deeply. Bless Pastor Brett with your presence of blessing. Help him in his words. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Well, we do have a lot to rejoice over, and especially rejoice with the Didos family of this wonderful news and just a wonderful answer to prayer. And we know that there's still a long road ahead of recovery, so keep them in your prayers. I want to invite you to turn to Ephesians 6. We're diving back into our little mini-series on the armor of God from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. And if you remember, several weeks ago, I preached kind of two introductory messages on this topic in which we kind of surveyed the Old Testament and the New Testament to kind of get some greater biblical context and background for this passage. And if you recall from our little survey of the Old Testament context, we saw in Exodus chapter 15 the phrase, Yahweh is a warrior. Yahweh being the sacred name of God in the Hebrew language. Yahweh is a warrior, and he fights to protect his people. And so when Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might, he's reminding us that we're not alone in this battle. Yahweh, the divine warrior, is with us. He is fighting for us, and he is guaranteeing our ultimate victory. We also saw in our little survey of the Old Testament that in Isaiah chapter 11 and Isaiah chapter 59, Yahweh the divine warrior is portrayed as wearing divine armor, armor of righteousness, faithfulness, and salvation. And this really is the context then for this phrase, the armor of God. And we concluded that when Paul says, put on the armor of God, he's saying that God has provided his own divine armor to us and that we are to clothe ourselves in it. He's made it available to us. We just have to put it on. Then we also looked at some of the New Testament context, and we specifically asked the question, what kind of power is in view in this passage? When Paul says, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might, he's talking about spiritual power. Well, what kind of power is he talking about? And we observed that the armor of God passage, right, begins with this exhortation towards strength and power, and it ends with Paul saying, pray for me that I will declare the gospel boldly and clearly as I ought to. So we begin with power and we end with the proclamation of the gospel. And what we did as we surveyed the New Testament, we saw that that's consistent with what the rest of the New Testament teaches about this concept of power. For example, in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, we saw that the gospel is the power of God. And in Acts 1, 8, we see that the Holy Spirit has given us power so that we can be his witnesses from Jerusalem to the ends of the earth. And so we concluded that the exhortation to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might in Ephesians 6:10 is intricately connected to the prayer for power which Paul prays in verses 19 through 20, the power to proclaim the gospel. In other words, the focus of spiritual warfare is the proclamation of the gospel. Satan desperately wants to either stop the messenger or pollute his message, because what he fears most is the proclamation of the gospel itself. When I was in seminary, I got a chance to interact with Steve Linetti, who was a missionary to a pagan jungle tribe who literally worshiped demons. They were so bound under these dark powers. They were just bound in the occult and in demonic worship. And then there was a radical transformation. They were freed from those demonic powers. They came to faith in Christ in mass. Virtually the whole tribe was saved. And when we asked Steve, what was the secret, right? What won this great spiritual battle against the forces of evil? He said it was very simple. We taught them the simple truths of the gospel. And when they learned and believed that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died on the cross for their sins, was raised from the dead, is ascended on high, and is coming again, they realized that all of the demonic powers they were worshiping were evil and also weaker than Christ. And they simply, through the power of the gospel, were rescued. So it is the proclamation of the gospel which is the core of spiritual warfare. Our responsibility is to overcome Satan's schemes and his opposition so that we can boldly and clearly proclaim the gospel, which Paul, using himself as an example, says, as I ought to do. So true spiritual power always manifests itself in the clear and bold proclamation of the gospel, because it is the gospel which is the power of God for salvation. It transforms the soul. It transforms the eternal destiny of people. And so it is the greatest and most powerful of all miracles. So the Old Testament context taught us that God is a warrior who fights for us, and that the armor of God is God's own armor, which he makes available to us, but we must put it on. And then the New Testament context taught us that the gospel is the power of God. And so the ultimate goal of putting on the armor is to be able to boldly and clearly proclaim the gospel. So kind of with the broader context of the Bible in mind, now we're going to go and we're going to spend some time looking at the context of the book of Ephesians. So we have the far context, which is all of Scripture, and then the near context, which is what is written previously in the book of Ephesians. If you remember from the beginning of our study, I gave you the outline that's on the screen, and we looked at the fact that the book is roughly divided into two different sections: the doctrinal section in chapters 1 through 3, and then the practical section in chapters 4 through 6. So you have the truths that God reveals in the first three chapters, and then how we're supposed to apply those truths to our lives in chapters 4 through 6. And the main idea of that first section, the doctrinal section, is that when a believer was united with Christ by faith, we received a new identity in him. We have a new identity in Christ. By faith, you were born again to a new life with a whole new identity. Chapter 1 teaches us that we were chosen in Christ. Chapter 2, that we are saved in Christ. And chapter 3, that we are united in Christ with God and with each other. So we are chosen, saved, and united in Christ. So this is a massive transformation, right? These are the glorious truths of the gospel. Whereas we used to be dead in our trespasses and sins, without hope and without God in the world, enslaved to the prince of the power of the air, the devil, now we are chosen, saved, and united in Jesus Christ. We have a new identity. We are a new creation in Christ. And then the practical section. What's the main idea of the practical section? The main idea of the practical section is that because we have a new identity in Christ, we now have a new purpose in life. We're a new creation with a new purpose. In chapter 4, we're told that we need to grow in Christ. In chapter 5, that we need to live in Christ. And that then brings us to chapter 6, where with the word finally, in chapter 6, verse 10, Paul introduces the last of this practical section, which is that we need to conquer in Christ. We need to grow in Christ, chapter 4, live in Christ, chapter 5, and now conquer in Christ in chapter 6. We have a new purpose. And to fulfill that purpose, we must overcome the devil. We must conquer through the power of Christ. And it is now to that goal of conquering Christ, that we now turn in Ephesians chapter 6, and we're going to read verses 10 through 13. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the full armor of God, so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Now, as we study these crucial verses phrase by phrase, we're going to see three crucial things about the armor of God. We're going to see the source of the armor of God, where it comes from. We're going to see the necessity of the armor of God, why we need it. And then we're going to see the purpose of the armor of God, what it is supposed to accomplish in our lives. So I want to invite you to look with me at verse 10, where we're going to see the source of the armor, the source of the armor. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Now I want you to look at that first verb there, be strong, right? Finally, be strong. Now, when we say be strong in English, it comes off as a very active verb, something that we're supposed to do, right? Gather your strength, show yourself strong, be strong, as if it's something that comes from within you. But in the original Greek, this verb is actually in the passive. It's actually something you receive from someone else. You could translate it, be made strong. But it's a really interesting verb because it's not only a passive showing that we receive this, it's also an imperative, right? And Greek verbs are very complex because they have all these different aspects, but it's also an imperative, meaning it's a command, something that we're supposed to do. The reason that English translations translate it as be strong, not be made strong, is because it's a command. It's something that we're supposed to do. So when you put the different aspects of the verb together, we see that this strength is something that doesn't originate with us. It actually originates with God, but it is something that we have to take action in order to apply. We have to receive the armor from God, and we have to put it on. This armor given to us by Yahweh the warrior, his own divine warrior, has been made available to us. It comes from him. It is given to us passively, right, from God, but we must obey the command to put it on. There's something else, though, that should jump out at us in verse 10, and it's the repetition of the word in. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Now, when we see the phrase in the Lord and in the strength of his might, we should remember the general theme of the book of Ephesians, which is union with Christ. Union with Christ. That's emphasized throughout the book of Ephesians. If you remember at the introduction, we said that the phrase in Christ or in him or in the Lord or in his might appears 36 times in the book of Ephesians. It's one of the key themes, that we by faith have been united with Christ, and therefore we are in him. And because we are now in him, we share his eternal life. We share his eternal inheritance. We share his eternal glory. Why do you have everlasting life if you're a believer? Because by faith you are united with Christ, therefore his resurrection becomes your resurrection. His eternal life becomes your eternal life. His inheritance becomes your inheritance. We are in him. But not only do we share in his life, his inheritance, and in his eternal glory, but we also share in his power. We are in him, and he is the omnipotent, sovereign King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We are in the Almighty One. So though we have a powerful, crafty, vile enemy, the devil, who seeks to destroy us, though we live in a fallen world with all of its trials and temptations, though we suffer from the weaknesses and sufferings of the flesh, we can face those foes with confidence because we know in whom we have believed. We know that we are in Christ, that we are protected by his power, that we are in him and he in us. We are united with him. Therefore, despite the constant attacks of the world, of the flesh, and of the devil, we can stand firm in the spiritual battle, knowing that we will be victorious in the end. As Paul says in Romans chapter 8, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. We're super conquerors because he has defeated the enemy. So our confidence is not based upon who we are, right? It's not our strength. It's a strength we receive and put on. Our strength is from Christ, and we rely on his strength. I want to take you to a verse that's on the screen before you that really explains this poignantly. It's 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. In context, John has been talking about the spirit of Antichrist, which is already in the world, and all the false teachers which the spirit of Antichrist has sent out into the world to deceive the nations. And he says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, "You are from God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world." It's a wonderful verse, one of my favorites. But notice how John describes us. He calls us little children. here in a context which he's talking about these horrific evil powers, the spirit of Antichrist, and all of the false teachers that have gone out through the whole world to deceive the nations. And he says, you know what, little children, you've been sent by God. Right? To use Jesus' analogy, right? Jesus said, I'm sending you out like sheep in the midst of wolves. Now, when you're going to send someone out into battle, you know, lambs don't seem like mighty warriors, right? Little children don't seem like mighty warriors, right? God sending little children out to face the devil and his minions seems like a losing proposition. We are little children. We are weak like little children. We are helpless like little children. In ancient warfare, it was the strongest, the biggest, the fastest who would prevail. Imagine sending a little child out against those mighty warriors. We're weak like little children. And yet, John says, you have overcome them. And the them is the spirit of the Antichrist. So how is it possible for little children to prevail in spiritual battle against the spirit of Antichrist, against the devil himself? Notice the first phrase in the verse. It says, you are from God. You're not just little children. You're little children sent by God. You were born again by God. Your new life is from God. Everything about you is from God. You are born again by the power of God and sent by him. Yes, like little children, we are weak, but we are sent on a mission from God. We fight this war at his command, by his power, and we are doing it in obedience to the Great Commission which Jesus gave us. But if you notice in the verse, it not only says that we're from God, it says that God is in us. Greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. We're from God and God is in us. He didn't just send his little children out into the battle to face the world, the flesh, and the devil all alone. Rather, he united them with Christ by faith and indwelled them by his Holy Spirit. And so God not only sent us, he went with us. And not just with us, but in us. Do you remember what Jesus said when he gave the Great Commission, right? The Great Commission is where he said, look, you know, look, go into all the world, preach the gospel, right? Go make disciples of all the nations. But do you remember what he said first? He said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples. And then remember what he said at the very end. He said, and lo, I am with you always, even to the ends of the age. Yes, I'm sending you out like sheep amongst wolves, but I'm not sending you out alone. I will be with you, not just with you, but in you, and you and me. And so John says, you are from God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Our confidence in battle comes not from our own strength, for we have none. Rather, it comes from Christ, for when we are weak, then he is strong. And so we can face the bitter attacks of the world, the flesh, and the devil with courage and confidence because we know that we are sent by God, with God, and in God. We are sent by the Father, we are in the Son, and the Spirit is in us. Yahweh, the divine and omnipotent warrior, goes into battle before us, behind us, beside us, because he is in us and we are in him. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You know, sometimes it doesn't seem that way, right? Sometimes it seems like the powers of darkness out in the world are so strong and so oppressively powerful that we're tempted to get weak-kneed and cowardly in the battle. But John is saying, look, you, yes, you're like a little child facing a mighty army, but don't forget who's with you and who's in you and who you are in. You're in the beloved Son. You're in Christ. And so Yahweh, the warrior, fights for you. That's the source of our strength. He is the source of our divine armor. So let's look now at the necessity of the armor. We've seen the source of the armor. Now let's look at the necessity. In Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 through 12, Paul writes, "Put on the full armor of God, so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places." Do you notice how many times he repeats the word against? We're in a war. We have a foe. We're fighting against the powers and rulers and authorities and spiritual forces of darkness. And so we need armor. We're little children. As little children, we're going out against a massively powerful foe. We have to be clothed in the armor of God. It is absolutely necessary. I want you to notice something in verse 11. He says, put on the full armor of God. Put it on. You know, if you remember back from our earlier studies, we've seen this word put on before in Ephesians. We've seen it in chapter 4, verse 24. And so I want to ask you to flip over there, because when Paul uses the same term, right, he's already talked about this idea of putting on earlier in the book. And now he repeats the exact same word in Greek to say put on the armor of God. So going back to the earlier context is going to be very instructive to help us understand what he means when he says put on the armor of God. Look at chapter 4, verses 21 through 24. It says, "If you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus, then in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and put on the new self, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth." So the verb put on in chapter 4, verse 24, is repeated in chapter 6, verse 11. And the link between chapter 4, verse 24 and chapter 6, 11 is really important for understanding how it is that we put on the armor of God. What does that mean to put on the armor of God? Paul has already explained in chapter 4 that there is a process of spiritual growth that occurs on an ongoing basis after we're saved. And that process of growth consists of three key steps. First, putting off sin. Secondly, renewing our mind. And third, putting on the new self, righteous replacements for former sins. And it's no accident that Paul uses the exact same word, put on, that he used in chapter 4, verse 24, to tell us to put on the armor of God. What is he doing? In chapter 6, verses 10 through 20, he's giving us more detail about that third step of the Christian growth process. What is it that we're to put on? We're to put on the new self. What does it mean to put on the new self? Paul's going to give us more information about what it means to put on the new self. He's going to talk about putting on the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness and the belt of truth and shoes that are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace and the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit. He's going to say, this is what you're supposed to put on. When I talked about putting on the new self, this is what I meant. It's no accident that Paul uses the exact same word, put on, in both places. He's giving us more information about that third step of Christian growth. In 4:24, we're specifically told to put on the new self. And notice that there are two things mentioned in verse 24. Put on the new self, he says, which in the likeness of God has been created, and here's the two things, in righteousness and holiness of the truth. So you have righteousness and holiness of the truth. Does that sound at all familiar? Those are the first two pieces of armor, the breastplate of righteousness and the belt of truth. So the parallel between chapter 4, verse 24 and the armor of God passage is crystal clear. In the armor of God passage, Paul's giving us more detail about what we're to put on in that third step of Christian growth. And that, by the way, tells us something very, very important. You can't put on the armor of God until you've taken something off. You can't put on the armor of God if you're still wearing the soiled garments of sin. So often people get frustrated because no matter how much they try to put on the armor of God, they still remain vulnerable to his attacks. Why is that? The most likely reason is because they can't put on the armor because they haven't taken off the sin. The armor is to protect us against Satan's temptations. It's hard to put on armor against temptation if you're indulging in the sin that he's tempting you. The most likely reason that we can't put on the armor of God is because we're still wearing some form of unconfessed and unrepentant sin. And so we won't be able to put on the armor of God until we peel off that filthy garment of sin, cast it far from us, and then renew our minds so that we hate that sin instead of loving it. Do you know why you sin? Because you want to. You know why you want to? Because you love sin. So to stop sinning, you have to actually change your mind, right? You have to get rid of the sin and then renew your mind so that instead of loving sin, you hate it. And instead of resenting holiness, you love holiness. A lot of Christians, if they were really honest with themselves, would have to admit that they actually kind of resent God's commands. They think they're burdensome. Even though Jesus said, "My commands are not burdensome," we're like, yeah, actually they are. They kind of are. Because you want me to stay away from certain things that I want to do, and you tell me to do things I don't want to do. So what's the key to change? You have to actually renew your mind, where instead of loving sin, you now hate it. Instead of hating righteousness, you now love it. You have to get rid of the sin, renew your mind, and then you can put on the armor of God. My friend, you cannot put on the armor of God until you peel off the dirty garment of unrepentant sin. This is both sobering and encouraging. I'll tell you why it's sobering. It's sobering because it means that we actually have to get serious about change, real change. And we have to be willing to do the hard work that it takes to produce substantial and long-lasting change. But it's also encouraging, and I'll tell you why, because it means that putting on the armor of God, there's not some mysterious key to it. There's not some secret to putting on the armor of God. You don't have to keep searching the internet hoping to find, you know, some teacher who can give you this secret to the armor of God. The secret key that you've been missing all your life to putting on the armor of God. There is no secret key. Putting on the armor of God is a lot more simple than you might think. It's not a secret you have to find. It's not a mystery you have to solve. It is spiritual disciplines that you have to do. The process of change is made simple and clear for us in chapter 4, verses 22 through 24. I'll put it on the screen for you. Put off sin. Got to get rid of it. Cut it off. You got to do whatever it takes to get rid of that thing. Cut it out of your life. Get rid of it. Then you got to renew your mind. You got to actually change your thinking through the Word of God. Then you got to put on the armor of God so that it can't come back. You got to put on the righteous replacement for your sin, the breastplate of righteousness. If you are stealing, you got to stop stealing and start giving. If you're filled with anger, you have to replace it with forgiveness and kindness. If you are lying, you have to speak truth. You have to get rid of the sin, change your mind about it, and then put on the armor of God so that when the enemy counterattacks, right? Hey, I got him with this once. I'm going to try it again. But the second time he tries it, now you're armored, and now you can fend off his attacks. The armor of God is key to not falling back into your old ways, right? You're supposed to put off your old ways, put on the new self. The armor of God is what helps you to not go back to your old ways. I want you to notice in chapter 4, verses 25 through 27, another parallel to the armor of God. He's giving examples of putting off and putting on. He says, "Therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger." And then look at verse 27. "And do not give the devil an opportunity." literally in the Greek, a place, a foothold, a spot. Satan's looking for the chink in your armor, right? He got you into sin. Now you've thrown off the sin. You've renewed your mind. You've put on the armor, but you kind of didn't put it all on. So there's still a place that he can attack. There's still that one area of your life that you've been withholding from the Lord. You've been holding on to some cherished sin, not giving your life fully to the Lord. Paul says, don't give the devil an opportunity. And do you notice the similarity between chapter 4, verse 27 and chapter 6, verse 11? In verse 11, it says, put on the full armor of God so you'll be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. So don't give him an opportunity. Stand against his schemes. So we have to use that three-step process of putting off, renewing our minds, and putting on the new self, putting on that armor in order to resist the attacks of the devil, to not give him a foothold to resist his schemes. So what's the point of this comparison with chapter 4? It's simply this. Good, old-fashioned spiritual growth is the key to putting on the armor of God. It is the spiritual disciplines of the word and prayer and fellowship and memorization of the word which are putting on the armor, the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the helmet of assurance of salvation, as we'll see through the parallel passage in Thessalonians. Feet ready to proclaim the gospel because you know the word of God. I want to take you to another passage which makes this idea very clear. Romans chapter 13. Verses 12 through 14. Romans chapter 13, verses 12 through 14, another Pauline epistle. And I want to point out to you the parallels and the way in which the armor is used in this passage. In context, Paul has been saying, look, it's time to wake up from your sleep, right? You've been in slumber. And then in verse 12 of Romans chapter 13, so Romans 13, 12, he says this, the night is almost gone, and the day is near. Therefore, and notice the similar terminology, therefore, let us lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. And then he goes on to explain what he means. Let us behave properly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts, right? Don't make any room for the flesh, right? Don't give the devil an opportunity. Put off the deeds of darkness. Put on the armor of light. The parallel passages in Ephesians 4 and Romans 13 and elsewhere make it clear that Paul was teaching a moral view of spiritual warfare, not a power encounter view. What do I mean by that? He was teaching a spiritual growth view of spiritual warfare, not a deliverance view. In Ephesians chapter 6, Paul is not teaching us how to do exorcisms. He's not teaching us how to bind demons. He's not teaching us how to break generational curses. All of those are absolutely foreign to the text and to the context of Ephesians. Rather, he is teaching us how to be victorious against Satan's deceptions and temptations. The key is spiritual growth through basic spiritual disciplines, and there are no shortcuts to that. Spiritual warfare is exactly what's described here in Romans 13. Let us lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. That is spiritual warfare. Behaving properly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy, but we put on the Lord Jesus Christ and we make no room for the flesh. That's spiritual warfare. So do you want to be clothed in the armor of God? Then you first need to peel off unconfessed sin. You need to be renewed in your mind by the word of God. And then you need to use the spiritual disciplines to put on the full armor of God. And you need to do this and do it immediately because you didn't sign up for a peacetime army and there's a real enemy out there seeking to destroy you. we are at war with the devil and his demons, and they are powerful. So it is absolutely necessary that we clothe ourselves in God's armor. Look back at Ephesians 6, verse 11. He says, put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm. And then he repeats that phrase, will be able, in verse 13. Take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day. In other words, if you don't put on the full armor of God, you won't be able to resist. You won't be able to stand firm. It's absolutely necessary to have this armor. You can't be victorious in the battle without it. We're locked in mortal combat against a vile, crafty, experienced, and powerful foe, the devil. He's highly intelligent. He is a strategic thinker. He has well-thought-out plans to lure you away from the truth, to lure you away from good morals. And why does he do that? Because he wants to destroy your gospel witness. And there are two ways to destroy a Christian's gospel witness. You can either pervert his message or you can discredit him as a messenger, either through false doctrine or through moral failure. He wants to either pervert the message you proclaim so that it's not the clear and bold gospel, or he wants to pervert your life so that you'll be a hypocrite, which no one will take seriously. He wants to pollute the message or discredit the messenger. And the devil and his demons are even now plotting to lure you away from the truth, plotting to lure you into temptations. In verse 11, it says, put on the armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. He has schemes. This is the Greek word methodias. We get our word methodical from this word. Satan is methodical in his attacks. He has well-planned strategies, long-term strategies, to lure you away from the truth, to lure you away from sound morals. So you need to be clothed in divine armor at all times, because you never know when the trap which he's been laying for you will be sprung. Clinton Arnold says, believers need God's empowerment because they will face a variety of well-planned attacks by a supernatural opponent. The devil is an intelligent being that carefully strategizes plans against the church, God's plan of redemption, and individual believers. MacArthur points out that Satan's schemes are built around stealth and deception. We're often deep in a trap before we even realize it. Snodgrass says that evil rarely looks evil until it accomplishes its goal. It gains entrance by appearing attractive, desirable, and perfectly legitimate. It is a baited and camouflaged trap. The enemy's favorite tactic is to dress false teachers in the clothing of gospel preachers and infiltrate the church. So whether it's an enticement to break God's commands or it's casting doubt on God's word, the enemy seeks to lure you into moral sin and doctrinal drift, right? Ephesians chapter 4, Paul warns us. He says, look, don't be like one of those who's blown here and there by every wind of doctrine. And he talks about holding firm to your moral convictions. He tells Timothy in his epistle to Timothy, watch your life and your doctrine closely. Right? Your doctrine is what you believe. You believe certain things about God, about Christ. You believe certain things are right and certain things are wrong. Certain things are commanded of you and certain things are forbidden of you. That's your doctrine. Satan wants to erode your doctrine so that your lines get blurry. You're no longer sure what's right and no longer sure what's wrong. And he wants to lure you into temptations. So watch your life and your doctrine closely. In other words, be on guard against the schemes of the devil, that methodical devil who wants to slowly but surely lure you away from the truth, lure you away from your moral convictions. Paul says, look, you got to armor up so that you will be able to stand firm. You know what your goal should be? Your goal should be that when you take your last breath here on earth, you'll be able to say, I faced all the attacks of the enemy and I was unmoved from the truth of God's word and from the moral convictions it teaches. I stood firm. The waves beat against me, they didn't move me. The attacks came against me, I didn't move. I stood firm. I stood on the truth. I stood on my moral convictions. You know, it's kind of an interesting tactic that I think the enemy uses sometimes. He leads us into a minefield. And you know how he gets you to go there? First, he gets someone else to go there. I was watching a documentary, and you know, it's rarely the first soldier that enters a minefield that steps on one and gets blown up. It's usually the second or third guy. Because the first guy is walking through and nothing happens to him. So everybody else says, oh, it must be safe. And they head into the minefield, and then boom, 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 there's a destruction. Same thing with an ambush, right? All of the military guys, you know how to set an ambush, right? You have to let the first half of the enemy column get through the ambush zone and then light them up. That's what the enemy does to the church. He has some false doctrine, and some Christians go there, and everyone else is kind of watching to see, hey, you know, can we abandon, you know, that doctrinal conviction? Can we kind of compromise on it, weaken a little bit? You know, just it's not a big deal. And we kind of watch our fellow Christians go down that road, and, you know, they go down that road, and, you know, we talk to them, and they still love Christ. They, you know, still pray and do all these wonderful things, and we say, hey, must not be a big deal. It doesn't seem to affect their spiritual life. And off we go after them. We don't realize they're in a minefield. They just haven't stepped on the mine yet. And it may be the second or third one which steps on it first. Be cautious about following your friends. Be cautious about following Christian teachers when they wander away from the doctrines and moral convictions taught in Scripture. The Scripture says that the faith is once and for all delivered to the saints. It's an unchanging body of truth. Be careful of those given to change. God's moral laws don't change with the opinions of man. Be careful about those who are constantly seeking a middle ground between the church's view and the world's view. The devil is a schemer. He knows how to lure us into a trap. So be alert and keep your armor on at all times. In verse 12, he says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, right? It's not the people. It's not even the false teachers. It's those who stand behind them. It is the rulers, the powers, the world forces of this darkness, the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places, all terms which are used in Scripture for demonic beings. Why are there so many terms here? Because just like holy angels have different types, cherubim and seraphim, and different ranks, archangel and angels, so also the demons and the demonic armies are organized into different types and different ranks of malevolent spiritual beings. In other words, we're facing a well-organized, well-led spiritual foe, a powerful enemy army. And like in ancient warfare, we are going to face them face to face in hand-to-hand, close quarters, personal combat. Look at verse 12. It says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers. That word struggle, the King James translates, says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Well, why did the King James use the word wrestle? Because the word used here was describing the ancient Greco-Roman sport of wrestling. And ancient soldiers would wrestle in their training because it prepared them for close quarters combat. Shield on shield, sword on sword, pressing, dodging, keeping your balance. Wrestling would train them to keep their footing in that intensity of that hand-to-hand combat. So when Paul says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, or we struggle not against flesh and blood, he's saying the combat is going to be face-to-face, eye-to-eye. It's going to be close quarters combat. I remember in high school, I wrestled in high school, and I had to wrestle this one guy, and he was pretty notorious in our district because he purposely would never wash his uniform. And he wouldn't bathe for a couple days before the match, and I'm convinced he soaked himself in urine even, because when you went to wrestle the guy, his stench was overpowering. And he used it to distract his opponents and to make them unwilling to close with him in combat. To win, you had to overcome his stench. Likewise, our battle against the devil is going to be no walk in the park. We're going to be eye to eye. We're going to be head to head, shield to shield. It's going to be a no holds barred, close quarters, knockdown, drag out, exhausting, brutal fight. And there will be time when you feel the enemy's breath on your neck. You will smell his stench. You will wilt under the power of his blows. You will recoil at the stench of his perverse evil. You will gaze into the darkness of his eyes and see his hatred. And you will think that there's no way to win. That is the moment, the evil day, when you must remember that your strength comes from the Lord. You got to remember who you are and who is in you, and know that he who is in you is greater than he that is in the world. I don't know how, what your situation is, how deep in you may be, or how hard pressed you may be, but I can tell you that you have strength in the Lord, in the power of his might. You can go eye to eye, face to face, blow to blow against the devil and prevail, not because you are strong, you're not, you're weak, but because God has provided divine armor for you and his divine power. So the source of the armor is God. The necessity of the armor is because we're facing a powerful and wicked foe. And that leads us to our third and last point, which is the purpose of the armor, verse 13. Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that, and here's the goal, so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm, right? Resist in the evil day and stand firm until the end. That is the purpose of the armor of God. What's the evil day? This is just a general term. The evil day is a general term for when Satan launches his attacks. He's methodical. He lays the groundwork for the ambush for a long time, but there does come a time when he springs, when he attacks, when he launches the ambush. That's the evil day. They come periodically throughout life. And when it comes, you can't let them take you by surprise. That's why the spiritual disciplines and consistency in the spiritual disciplines is so important, so that you have your armor on and you don't get taken by surprise. You don't get overcome by a sneak attack from the devil. So you can't take breaks from the spiritual disciplines. You can't take breaks from attending church, reading the word, prayer, because when you take breaks from doing that, your armor is off and you're vulnerable to attack. You need to be strong in the Lord, put on the armor, never take it off until the battle is over. You know, ancient armies used to maneuver sometimes for days or weeks and never close to battle. And so sometimes one side would kind of get a little lazy. It's like, hey, you know, they've just been kind of sitting over there, moving here, moving there. They never attack us. And so they get kind of lazy. They don't put their armor on. They're just kind of, and then the enemy who has been doing all those maneuvers has been watching for his opportunity. He sees it and he strikes. Don't let the devil do that to you. Be consistent in the spiritual disciplines which are described in the armor of God. Righteousness, the word of God, prayer, faith. Be strong in the Lord, put on the armor so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. You have to do everything. Well, what's the everything he's referring to? He's referring to all of those practical instructions he's been giving us throughout the book of Ephesians. You got to do all those things. And having done them all, stand firm to the end. How's your armor? How's your armor? Next week, we're going to be talking about the different pieces of the armor and how the spiritual disciplines enable us to put them on. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word, which encourages us, letting us know we're not alone in the fight. Lord, I'm sure there are many in this room who are feeling overwhelmed or maybe even overpowered by the enemy. Lord, help them to stand, to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of your might. We thank you that you have not sent us forth as lambs in the midst of wolves alone. You've said, I am with you always. You've not sent us out as little children to face the foe alone. You've said, I am with you. You are in me and I in you. And Lord, we thank you and praise you that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, we know the battle is real, but God provides the strength we need to defeat the foe. As we sing the song again, I'd invite you to sing it to each other as a challenge. Please stand.
Oh, church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain. For now the weak can say that they are strong. Give us strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold, whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor. And with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor. When faced with trials on every side, we know the outcome is secure. Christ will have the prize for which he died, an inheritance of nations.
Oh,
go now in the power of his might. Go in peace.
Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here.